takes the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like a sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Thank you. with all creation, cry out, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, let faith be the song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it down every wall and watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lift him high. With all creation cry out, we praise you. Freedom feels like this is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall and watch the giants fall. They cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. We'll see you break down every wall and watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, So pour out your spirit with love to renew you, oh God. When you come with our heads to the heavens alive in your presence, oh God. When you come, so pour out your spirit with love to renew you, oh God. When you come, come like a rushing wind, come like a fire again, come like a burning flame. Have your way, have your way. Oh. Come like a rushing wind, come like a fire again, oh. Come like a burning flame. Have your way, have your way. I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance to the exodus of my heart. As you found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Adonai, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out in freedom into the promised land. Now I will not forget you. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You stepped into my Egypt. You took me by the hand. You marched me out of freedom into the promised land. Now I'll not forget you. I'll sing of all you've done. Death is swallowed up forever by the fury of your love. You're the God. Hallelujah. of you, I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, here.
Promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that Dear Jesus, we thank you that we can rest, that you will never change, that you are truly our hope, that you make a way when there is no way. Lord, you're really all that we need, and that will never change. And I thank you that we can hold on to you, that you are steadfast, that you are faithful. Even when we are faithless, you remain faithful. Thank you for that, Lord. Thank you that we can stand on your firm foundation. Help us to do that. Help our hearts to cling to you today. Have your way in this service and in our hearts, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And welcome to Grace at Home. And before we get into our teaching on Luke chapter 4, that's right, we actually finished chapter 3 and chapter 2. Yay! It was chapter 2 that was the long one. But we're going into chapter 4 during the first 13 verses today. But let's pray for our friends that haven't yet come to know Jesus. And let's pray for ourselves as we open up God's Word today. Let's do that right now. Father, thank you for our friends that haven't yet come to know you. We ask that you would visit with them, that you would pour out your grace and your mercy and your compassion on them. Lord, do whatever it takes to bring our friends into your kingdom. And Lord, if you'd like to use us, we're available. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. And Lord, we thank you for your word. We ask that as we open it up, that you would open up our hearts to hear from your Holy Spirit what you have to say to your church today. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We'll open up your Bibles to Luke chapter 4. As I said, we're going to read the first 13 verses. It says, "Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. Jesus ate nothing at all at that time and became very hungry." I bet 40 days no eating, I think I'd be hungry after a couple hours. Anyway, "Then the devil said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become a loaf of bread.' But Jesus told him, 'No, the scriptures say, people do not live by bread alone.' Then the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. 'I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them,' the devil said, because they are mine to give to anyone I please. I will give it all to you if you will worship me.' Jesus replied, 'The scriptures say, you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him.' Then the devil took him to Jerusalem, to the highest point of the temple, and said, 'If you are the Son of God, jump off, for the scriptures say, he will order his angels to protect and guard you, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone.' Jesus responded, 'The scriptures also say, you must not test the Lord your God.' When the devil had finished tempting Jesus, he left him until the next opportunity came." Notice it doesn't say the devil just left. He left until the next opportunity came. Does the same thing to you, does the same thing to me. He knows what we can be tempted by. A guy who has not eaten for 40 days and 40 nights can easily be tempted by bread, wouldn't you say? Especially if it was fresh made bread and the aroma was just kicking up. Anyway, making me hungry. I haven't eaten yet. But I want you to recognize that this temptation happened immediately following Jesus' great experience with and call from God. He went, he was baptized, Holy Spirit came down in the form of a dove, God spoke out loud to everybody there, "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." Remember? Excuse me. And immediately following that, this great time of temptation comes. And you know, this isn't really that unusual. It's a normal thing to happen with something when God gives you a great blessing, the enemy's going to try to come along and take it away. Isn't he? Mm-hmm. Have you had that happen to you before? Jesus had it happen to him. And let's look at what Satan might use to try to rip off our blessings from God. Let's look in Luke 4 to see the details of the temptations. He was tempted with hunger to begin with. He tempted the physical man, the flesh. In the verses 2-4, it says, where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days, Jesus ate nothing at all at that time and became very hungry. I think he was hungry the whole time. Then the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, I'm going to stop there for a second. In all of these temptations, the devil is challenging whether Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus doesn't even say anything about that. He doesn't even recognize that. Because Jesus knows who he is. And see, you and I, we need to know who we are in Christ. Because I guarantee you, the devil's coming along and he's trying to make you believe that you don't really belong to Christ. You don't really belong to Jesus. Your prayer for forgiveness didn't count. But it did. Jesus didn't even acknowledge it. Because it was stupid. And the devil says, if you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become a loaf of bread. It was in the desert, so it was hot enough. But Jesus told him, no, the scriptures say, people do not live by bread alone. The scriptures say. See, we live in a sensual society. We live in a society that is driven by the desires of the flesh. And I'm pretty sure Jesus had a really large desire of the flesh after 40 days of not eating. Wouldn't you say? Mm-hmm. That wasn't a little temptation. But notice that he didn't let his flesh be in charge. That's the problem with so many people in the world today. We live by our sensual desires, things we feel. People don't want to know what you think. They want to know what you feel about something, right? Mm-hmm. They want you to live by your sensual desires. God doesn't want you to live by your sensual desires. Jesus was living by what the Word of God said. And he knew what the Word of God said. Hebrews 12:15-17 says, look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Watch out that no poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you, corrupting many. Make sure that no one is immoral or godless like Esau, who traded his birthright as the firstborn son for a single meal. Sensual desires. Same temptation Jesus had. Esau failed, Jesus passed. You know that afterward, when he wanted his father's blessing, he was rejected. It was too late for repentance, even though he begged with bitter tears. See, so God doesn't want us to be like Esau, living by our fleshly desires. Esau traded everything for a bowl of soup. I'm sorry, that had to have been a really good bowl of soup. I mean, think about it. He was home. He could have just gone in the kitchen, made himself something himself. But he wanted what Jacob had. Didn't work out so well for him. And if we live like that, it won't work out so well for us either. 1 Peter 2:11, dear friends, I warn you as temporary residents and foreigners to keep away from worldly desires that wage war against your very souls. So to keep away from worldly desires, the flesh. See, the flesh can't be in charge. People live like this, body, mind, spirit. But Jesus wants us to live, and this is how he lived in the desert there, and the whole time he lived on this planet. He didn't live body, mind, spirit. He lived spirit, mind, body. Spirit, mind, body. The spirit's leading, so the mind agrees, so the body follows what the mind and the spirit tell them to do. That's the right way to live. Not and people live by flesh, mind, then spirit, if they live by spirit at all. If they live by spirit, most of the time it's not godly spirits. But we need to keep away from that because they wage war against our souls. And we need to win that war. Spirit, mind, body. Spirit in charge. 2 Timothy 2:22, run. Why do you stop after saying run? It's an important word in this sentence. Run from anything that stimulates youthful lust. Instead, pursue righteous living, faithfulness, love, and peace. Enjoy the companionship of those who call on the Lord with a pure heart. I love hanging out with people that are just real Christians. They live their Christianity out loud. I love it. You know, and most of those people, you don't even have to ask them if they love the Lord or where they go to church or anything like that. Because it's flowing out of them, you know? But he says, run from anything that stimulates youthful lust. A lot of times, the people we hung out with before we knew Jesus are not the right people to hang out with now. You might say, well, they need to know that Jesus loves them too. Yeah, somebody else probably should tell them. Or maybe you should tell them in a phone call or a letter or an email or whatever. But a lot of times we get around those people, we start acting like those people, don't we? I don't want to act like that anymore. I don't want to be like that anymore. I want to, like this says, enjoy the companionship of those who call on the Lord with pure hearts. Those are the people that we need to be. Those are the people we need to hang around with. Am I making sense? Jesus was that kind of person. As he wandered through the desert, being tempted, as you and I are, by the devil. Romans 8:1 out of the New King James Version. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Who do not walk according to the flesh. There's no condemnation for those people. I often make a joke, there's no condemnation in Jesus, and there's no crying in baseball. But if we're not walking according to the flesh, if we're not following the flesh, if we're not following the sensual desires, if we're not following our feelings, oh, just follow your heart. Don't do that. The heart is evil beyond cure, and who can know it? That's in an important book. It's called the Bible. Jesus lived by the Bible. I want to tell you something about Jesus living by the Bible. For you and me, it would be really easy for us to live by the Bible. Not so with Jesus. See, we I'm looking at my computer. The Bible's on my computer. I can look at the Bible on my phone. I have tons of Bibles all around in book form. I have every version of the Bible you could probably think of in book form. Not so with Jesus. In order for Jesus to know the scriptures like Jesus did, I know they taught it in Hebrew school as he was growing up, but to really know it, he would have had to have gone to the synagogue often. And I think he did. When his parents found him in the temple, what did he say? Didn't you know I had to be about my father's business? What was he doing? He's sitting there with the high priest and stuff, talking to him about scripture. I think Jesus spent a lot of time in the synagogue because everybody didn't have a Bible back then. Everybody didn't even have a scroll of a book of the Bible back then. But Jesus knew the scripture. He worked hard to make sure that he knew what the scriptures say. And why am I saying that? Because you and I have it easy. And we should do the same thing Jesus did. We should pull out our phone or put in our CD that reads the Bible out loud or use our Bible app on our phone to read the Bible out loud or read the Bible on our computer or whatever it is. We need to know God's Word. It amazes me how many Christians that have been a Christian for a long time have not even read the Bible all the way through even once. Jesus worked that hard to know what the scriptures say. Galatians 5:16 says, "So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves." We need to follow what the Holy Spirit is leading us to do, like Jesus did. Well, the next thing he's tempted with is greed. Look at the 5th through 8th verse of chapter 4. It says, "Then the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment. I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them, the devil said, because they are mine to give to anyone I please. I will give it all to you if you will worship me." Now, first of all, devil's lying. The Bible makes it very clear that God establishes kingdoms. Even bad ones. He does. Anyway, Jesus replied, "The scriptures say, you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him." So, bread, scriptures say, man shall not live by bread alone. Power, greed, scriptures say, must worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Knew the Bible pretty well. And he's following the Holy Spirit. 1 Timothy 6, verses 5 through 11. So Paul's speaking to Timothy and says, "These people always cause trouble. Their minds are corrupt, and they have turned their backs on the truth. To them, a show of godliness is just a way to become wealthy." Anybody heard of Robert Tilton? He's still at it down in Miami. "Yet true godliness with contentment is itself great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave it. So, if we have enough food and clothing, let us be content. But people who long to be rich," in other words, listen to that, people who long to be rich, people who want to be rich, "fall into temptation and are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction." For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Another translation that says, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. But either way, there's all kinds of evil that money can lead us into. The love of money. Money itself is just a tool. Depends on what you're doing with it, right? And some people craving money have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows. But you, Timothy, are a man of God. Here's that word again. So run from all these evil things. Pursue righteousness and a godly life along with faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness. You, Timothy, are a man of God. You don't need to be chasing after money. See, that seems to be the problem, is that people that love money. What do I mean by love money? Well, money is the desire of their life. Like you and I, the desire of our life is to please God. To some people, the whole purpose of their life is to collect more money. A long time ago, Howard Hughes was the richest man in the world. They asked him, Howard, how much money is enough money? He says, one more dollar than you have. The love of money is never satisfied. People think, oh, if I just win the lottery. I can't remember the statistic right now, but a great percentage of people who have won the big lottery have been bankrupt within just a couple of years after winning huge amounts of money. You see, because the money was not the answer. That money was their God. I'm going to follow this money wherever it takes me. Don't love money, love God. Because God's never going to leave you. Hebrews 13:5, I mean, your money can leave you, can it? Mm-hmm. Like these people who go bankrupt just a couple of years after winning the big lottery. Hebrews 13:5 tells us that. Don't love money. Be satisfied with what you have. For God has said, I will never fail you. I will never abandon you. See, God's not going to fail you. Your money can. You can think you are just the best investor in the entire world, and all of a sudden your investment goes down to nothing. Uh-oh, God died. My God's never going to die. Oh, he did once and rose again from the dead. Kind of a different thing. Your stuff will leave you. Jesus won't. Luke 12, verses 15 through 20. Then Jesus said, beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you own. Life is not measured by how much you own. Then he told them a story. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. He said to himself, what should I do? I don't have room for all my crops. Then he said, I know, I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But my name's not Mary. But God said to him, you fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for? The IRS. When we live for money, it's a very, very empty life. See, people waste their entire life earning wealth and losing what's important. Now, don't get me wrong, you have to have a job or some way of paying your bills. because it's really not a good thing to not pay your bills. It's an even worse thing to not pay your taxes. If you don't believe me, just try it. All these people running around, Texas is a republic. I don't recognize the authority of the United States of America because Texas is a republic. Yeah, well, they recognize you and they know where you are and they know how to throw you in jail. Colossians 3:5. So put to death the sinful earthly things lurking within you. Lurking within you. Have nothing to do with sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Don't be greedy. For a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. So he spends a longer time on that than he does sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. He stops to take a minute with the greedy part. Because he said, if you're greedy, money is your idol. Stuff, all the stuff that you want, that's your idol. If you're living for stuff, that has become God. Am I making sense? Mm-hmm. And we shall have no other God before us. Behold, the Lord your God is one God. That's what Scripture says. Lastly, he questioned his faith in God and God's concern for him. What do I mean by that? Well, look at the 9th through the 12th verse. So then the devil took him to Jerusalem to the highest point of the temple and said, once again, if you are the Son of God, questioning his whole purpose for being here, jump off. For the scriptures say, now he's twisting scripture out of context. Scripture does say this, actually. He will order his angels to protect you and guard you, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. And Jesus responded, one more time, the scriptures also say, you must not test the Lord your God. He's tempted three times. The scriptures say, the scriptures say, the scriptures say. The devil comes back with another argument. The scriptures say, right? Finally, the enemy goes off pouting because he can't get Jesus to do anything he wants him to do. Hebrews 11:6 says, and it is impossible to please God without faith. Jesus had faith in God. So much so that he worked really hard to learn what the Bible said. He wasn't born with the Bible in his head. He was born like you and me. He had to learn everything that you and I have to learn. The only thing is, he wasn't sinful. Proverbs 3:5-6. We read this a lot lately. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do. Seek His will in all you do. See, I think a lot of times we live our life seeking God's will in some of the things that we do. This says, in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Don't you want to know what path God thinks is good for you? I do. I'd like him to show me which path to take every single time I have a choice in my life to take this road or that road. I love Robert Frost's poem, The Road Not Taken, because it's just sort of the way I've lived my life, taking the road less traveled. And I think God wants us often to take that road. We talked about this last week, so I'm not going to talk about it a lot. Genesis 3:1, the oldest trick in the book I have here in my notes. The serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. One day he asked the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?" See, in this, these temptations, did God really tell you to do this? You can eat, come on. You can jump off the temple, that's no big deal. If you're the Son of God, the angel's going to come, they're going to pick you up by their hand, not let you hurt yourself. No, probably not going to die, but you're going to live a long time, got to spend a long time in the hospital. And I imagine those hospitals weren't very good. Oh, come on, worship me. I'll make you the kingdom. You know, I'll make you ruler of all these kingdoms and stuff. And no. No, because God said you shall worship the Lord and serve him only. That's what God said. See, the devil tried his best. He tried the same stuff he was trying with Eve, just different words. Am I making sense? Just different words. But all of it was, you know, if you are the Son of God. Did God really say you're his son? Did God really say you can't eat? Did God really say you can't have these kingdoms right now? Did God really say that you can't jump off this temple? Did he specifically say you can't jump off this temple? Jesus knew what the word said, and he followed the Holy Spirit. It is written, it's translated in other translations. You might say, why do you keep talking about different translations? Isn't it just one Bible? Well, yeah. There is, but a lot of people have translated it. Some have translated it for use kind of as a textbook in Bible colleges. And so it's worded more like a textbook. How many people like reading textbooks? Anybody? I know, bored me to death. And others, like the one I'm using right now, is just more conversational the way you and I would say it if we said it. The Greek is not like English, and so what you have to do in translating it is you have to take, not, it's not word for word, because even the word structure is different in Greek than in English, so we'd be saying sentences backwards and mixed up. It's really, when I went over to Ukraine and had to use a translator, a person that would translate what I was saying when I was teaching and preaching, I learned that you can't say hi, you can't say that. My name is Don. You can't do that. Because they interpret phrase by phrase. Because Russian and Ukrainian is very much similar to Greek. So it's the same thing here. The people that were translating these books, they translated them phrase by phrase. So, I don't know why I had to get into that, but it's important to find a version of the Bible. Just make sure it is the Bible. And a translation that you understand. It is written. Do you know what is written? Satan's scheme is to cause you to doubt. But if you know what is written, Jesus said you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. He did not say you will feel the truth, and the truth will set you free. Part of the truth sometimes makes you feel bad. Because we feel bad that we've disappointed God. But the nice thing is we feel good. Because when we come to him and we confess that we've disappointed him and that we know we've disappointed him, he forgives us. Because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. But so Jesus didn't say, you'll feel the truth and the truth will set you free. Woo! He didn't say that. He said, you will know the truth. Do you know what is written in the Bible? Do you know the truth? All of the truth? And nothing but the truth? See, Satan wants to cause you to doubt. Psalms 119:11. What Jesus did, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. That's what Jesus did. And it was like I said earlier, it was a very difficult task to memorize that many scriptures back in those days. He had to go hang out at church. That's where the Bible was. You know, not the whole Bible, the first half of the Bible. And in my opinion, that was even harder to find those nuggets of, you know, grace and mercy and compassion and the heart of God, because there are different kinds of stories in there. Psalms 1, verses 1 through 3. Oh, the joys of those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or stand around with sinners, or join in with mockers. But they delight in the law of the Lord, meditating on it day and night. They are like trees planted along the riverbank, bearing fruit each season. Their leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. See, we don't need to hang around with the people of this world making fun of the things of God. No, we need to delight in the truth, delight in God's book, and learn what it says by meditating on it day and night. That's what Jesus did to overcome these temptations. Notice he wasn't tempted, and then he ran to the synagogue to find out what the scriptures say. That was a little bit too late. He was prepared because he'd already learned to follow the Spirit. He'd already taken the time to go and find out what the Word of God said. And like I said, they only had the Old Testament back then. He was prepared. Are you prepared? Do you know what the Word of God says? Have you even read the whole thing once? I mean, that might be the first thing that you do. Is decide, you know what? I'm going to read through the scripture once, at least. And then I'll go back and relook at the stuff that I need to relook. We read through the Bible, or this year when we didn't do the whole Bible, we're doing the New Testament. Okay? But we read the Bible every day together. Because it's important. Hebrews 4:12 says, for the word of God is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. Why is that important? Remember what we talked about before? God wants to cause us to stop thinking like the world and start thinking like him. Stop agreeing with the world and agreeing with him. Read Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. And the way he does this is through the Word of God. We read God's book. It pierces our hearts. It divides the soul and the spirit. And it exposes our thoughts. Well, why does it need to do that? Because sometimes we don't realize how evil stupid our thinking is until it's exposed to the truth. And then all of a sudden, oh wow, I never saw that before. I need to agree with that and stop agreeing with the way I've been thinking about this. We just need to read God's word. Because God wants to do spiritual surgery on you. See, I have a problem with my hands that is apparently caused by a nerve and that goes from here up to my hands called the ulnar nerve. And it's apparently trapped in there somewhere, both arms. And so my hands have lost most of their feeling. Nothing more than feelings. No. So I could just do nothing. And then eventually my hands won't be able to do anything. That doesn't seem like a good choice, does it? Or I could let somebody with a sharp knife do surgery and release that nerve so that maybe how they feel will stop feeling this way, but positively, they won't get worse. I think I'll take the knife. Doesn't that seem like the smart choice?
Yeah.
Same thing with us. We can run around doing nothing about our stinking thinking. I think that phrase is just really funny. Anyway, I want God to expose my innermost thoughts and do surgery on them so that I can agree with Him. How about you? Mm-hmm. But that starts with letting this Word of God that is alive and powerful move into us. How does that happen? It's a thing called reading. I don't like to read. That's okay. Just get a free app. It's called YouVersion Bible app. Get that on your phone. You can choose any version of the Bible. And the cool thing is, if you have an internet connection, it'll read it to you. So you can't say, oh, I can't read very well. I'm sorry the public schools have let you down. But the Bible app is there to set you free, brothers and sisters. Ephesians 6, verses 17 and 18 says, put on salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert, be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. I read this verse to point out that the Word of God is the sword of the Spirit, and it's the only offensive weapon that we have. It was the weapon Jesus used in the desert directly against the devil. Devil made a temptation, Jesus said, it is written. Devil made a temptation, Jesus said, it is written. Devil made a temptation, Jesus said, it is written. Vah! Got him. Won that match. Why? Because the Word of God is an offensive weapon. I don't mean it's a weapon that offends you. I heard there's a school district around here that's banning the Bible from its library. I'm like, in Texas? Really? Yeah, Bible, it's just awful, isn't it? You might learn something about God, that would be bad. But see, Jesus knew what the Word said, because it wasn't banned from His school. It wasn't. And just to sidetrack for a second, I know I'm about to run out of time, but in the early schools in the United States, the Bible was a textbook for more than just religious studies. They used the Bible to learn to read, They learn the Bible, they use the Bible for a lot of different things. Now, we don't use it in our schools at all. Jesus knew what the Word said, even though it was difficult for him to do that. Jesus knew who he was. He knew he was the Son of God. There's no question. I'm not even gonna, you know, talk about that one because that's stupid. That's who I am. You need to know who you are. You've been redeemed. You've been set free. You've been forgiven. You have a place with Jesus in eternity. He's coming back for you soon. That's who you are if you've surrendered to Jesus. If you haven't, well, you probably are whoever the devil says you are. I would recommend surrendering your life to Jesus if you haven't already. But he defeated the devil. He showed us how to do it. Didn't he? It is written. It is written. So learn what is written. Put it inside you so that you won't sin against him. 2 Corinthians 10, verses 3 through 5. If you're a Christian and you don't have this marked in your Bible, you should. 2 Corinthians 10, 3 through 5. We are human, but we don't wage war as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons. We have weapons. Not worldly weapons. To knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. I meant to put this down in another translation, but this is okay too. Basically, the devil wants to set up strongholds in your life. What are those strongholds? They're thought systems that disagree with God. We need to tear those down. How do we tear those down? Well, we take captive every argument that it presents itself against Christ. So, devil says something that's against the Word of God. We take that captive. How? With the Word of God. And we make every one of our thoughts obey Christ instead of obeying the world. That's how we win the war against the devil in our lives. Am I making sense? Mm-hmm. When I got a hold of this as a young adult, it truly changed the way I lived. It changed my life. We need to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. We need to know what God's word says. Jesus followed the Spirit. But beyond that, he knew what the word of God said. He knew the truth, and the truth set him free. We need to do the same thing. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you that you gave us the example of Jesus in the desert. Lord, I thank you that you didn't use a bunch of fancy arguments against the devil. You used something that all of us have. You used the Bible. I pray for my brothers and sisters out there that are watching. Pray for myself and my family. That we would do the same thing that you did. That we would know what your word says. And then when the devil comes knocking, we do the same thing you did. Devil, it is written. And devil, yes, I am a son of God. I am a child of God. That's not a question anymore. My sins have all been forgiven because of what Jesus did for me on the cross. And yes, God did really say, yes, God did really say. And beyond that, this is what he said. So leave me alone. Lord, I pray that we could do that. Every day. I pray that we could get to know your word better and better and better and better and better. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. And before we end today, if there is somebody out there that's watching and listening, or maybe you're not watching, maybe you're listening in from another room because you didn't want to come watch some preacher on the internet. But you need to make your life right with God. I have a simple prayer for you, if that's you. Because God would love to get things right with you. God would love to forgive you of all of your sin. God would love to make a place for you in eternity with Him. Forgiven, clean. And if that's you, I have a simple prayer that I'd like to lead you in. And everybody, if you're a Christian or if you're not, I'd like everybody to pray this prayer out loud so that the person that really needs to pray this prayer out loud won't feel uncomfortable. If you'd like to do that, I'd like to lead you in that prayer. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus.
Thank you for dying on the cross for me.
Thank you for dying on the cross for me.
I admit that I'm a sinner.
I admit that I'm a sinner.
I ask that you would forgive me of my sin.
I ask that you would forgive me of my sin.
Come into my life.
Come into my life.
Be the Lord of my life.
Be the Lord of my life.
And I will follow you.
And I will follow you.
For the rest of my life.
For the rest of my life.
Baptize me with your Holy Spirit.
Baptize me with your Holy Spirit.
It's in your name, Jesus.
It's in your name, Jesus.
That I pray.
That I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, if you prayed that prayer and you meant it, and you needed to pray that prayer to get right with God today, tell somebody. Tell somebody that you trust. If you can't find anybody else to tell, go to gracefellowship.net, not .org or .com, gracefellowship.net. Hit email the pastor. That's me. And tell me that you prayed it. I'd love to hear from you. God bless you. And see you next time on Grace at Home.